Yeah, yeah, it's working. I got this in 2011, and I take the batteries out of it every now and again, so every time I power it up, it thinks it's 2011 still.
Aww.
A nice reminder of how old it is. Simpler times.
Yeah.
It's like, if I could go back to 2011.
I hear you, buddy.
Yeah. He's like, no pandemic?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And all that.
2011. Yeah.
That's a good year.
Yeah. Like, oh, you're in the first Obama administration.
Like 2 years away from divorce. But that's actually kind of like a little better now, so but the first thing that I love about your band is that I think there's like a really strong place in rock right now that's missing music, and the best way that I can describe it is like to have that sound where you can actually like sing the guitar part. And I think a lot of bands kind of miss that now, and like, you know, you can hear it where it's like, even if you're not singing, just having the guitar going,
yeah,
it's like you can kind of sing along the guitar part in that way. What is it like, you know, being that kind of noisy, but like not, you know, it's like it's not metal, but it's not like, it's noisier than like other, you know, music, so.
Yeah, I mean, well, the thing you're describing about hummable guitar lines, I think is just the fact that I'm a guitar player way more than I am, like, a singer. Like, I've been playing guitar for a lot longer than I've been singing in bands. So, like, the first thing that comes to me is guitar melodies, for sure. It's a thing I've always liked in other bands where, you know, no matter how much I like a singer, I want to hear some sort of counterpoint with them and, like, instruments, like, communicating back to them. So, like, I like the give and take of instrumental melodies versus vocal melodies and like that whole thing. Yeah.
What was the question?
We were talking about bands where there's like strong, hummable guitar lines and how that like kind of like comes in and out of being like in fashion or like prevalent in like rock bands.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I find it interesting too because today, hip-hop sells, and there's not much melodic element.
Oh, I don't know, man. I would disagree with that.
Okay.
I feel like there's extremely catchy hip-hop. But, like, I feel like, and when that is done right, there is, you know, this, because hip-hop is pop at this point, you have a lot, like, more focus and, like, fucking smart motherfuckers finding ways to do new, like, ebb and flow of, like, vocal bursts and, like, the hook. Honestly, like, a lot of our songs are, in a way, like, here's the verse, here's the, like, the good, like, instrumental hook. Like, Wine Flies is a good example of that, I think.
I think so.
Yeah.
And there's a build and a texture and one of the things, I'm not even sure what the question is. Gotcha. I mean, one of the things that I enjoy about this band a lot, and I can take a step back and look at it objectively. There's times you've got the pop hooks that happen, and then there's a texture, not texture per se. Your voice will carry one thing. The guitar does, it's its own element that sometimes intertwines with the vocals, and sometimes it backs the vocals, and sometimes it's like it sets a whole different angle on it, and then you can bring the guitar in to change that, or you can bring in the vocals to change that, or whatever, or you use the drums, or you know, a bass, or whatever it is. I mean, it's like there's, you know.
Yeah, I mean, it's like in a way, I feel like we're just describing what a band does.
What a good band does.
What a good band does, sure. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, a thing that I always look for in, like, guitar projects is, like, melodies that feel, like, feral and, like, feral and ecstatic, like, guitar melody thing. It's like, you know, Husker Du, obviously, like, big influence. Like, that era, you know, like, going over into, like, Fugazi and all that stuff. And then, like, you know, there are still bands that are, like, doing interesting things in that zone, but I think that I have a tendency to pull from, like, my background of being interested in guitar shredders and finding ways to try and make that new, which, like, lends to the, like, we were joking today about, like, all this, like, corny 80s guitar shit, and, like, how to make that. A lot of that has like passed into like history, which allows you to pull on those threads and like try and make some of your own again in a way that was like not possible for a while. And like I think when we were coming up, yeah.
So it's like a lot of Flash now, like just that, trying to bring back Flash or like the things like that.
I mean, Flash is a great player. I like definitely grew up on just like reading corny ass guitar magazines before getting more into like, I don't know, like less structured like noise and experimental music. But you know, there's like a joy to that guitar playing that I want. That like runs parallel to like ecstatic experimental stuff that I care about, like Albert Eiler, like Boredoms or stuff like that. And I don't know, it feels more legit for me to try and channel some of that like ecstatic energy of like, again, the Boredoms or Albert Eiler, like Freesia, like that sort of thing. But pulling on like where I come from, which is like Western Massachusetts in the 80s and 90s. Yeah.
And the thing is, too, is like the sound just all comes together. Like, you know, like a lot of bands, like you'll hear where it's like, okay, they're individuals, but like your band just feels like one, you know, sound.
That's great.
In such unison, you know.
It's a weird comparison, but a thing I think about a lot is the production ethos of Motorhead, which is.
Interesting. Didn't
well,
expect that one.
I know, like, this is, you know, again, goes back to, like, teenage me, but there were all these quotes about, like, taking three players and, like, they mix, like, it's a punchline, but mix everything louder than everything else, which means kind of mix everything at the same volume, and, like, so that it becomes one molten band. And I like that. I mean, if you're going to, like, you know, that's the thing I like about using distortion in music, is you can then blend a bunch of instruments together and a bunch of different people so they sound like one.
Yeah. So you have three albums named after planets.
Correct.
Are you going to do the entire solar system?
Correct.
That's the plan?
Yeah.
Are you going to do Pluto?
We have plans for Pluto.
So maybe, like, something. You do, like, an EP.
Is it that obvious?
Yeah. I'm kind of pushing for some side tapes that are... There's been talks about comets and things like that.
Well, yeah, there's other dwarf planets aside from Pluto, too, that would be really fun to include.
Yeah. And the, you know, a little, like, offshoots of the planets, like, they're... little moons and stuff. It's a little, you know, little things that go around or whatever.
Yeah. Yep.
Astrology.
Yep.
I mean, there's about 300 objects that you can chase after all the same, you know.
Yeah. Well, there's like, you know, there's at least four dwarf planets that we could easily do EPs out of. And then there are other, like, you know, orbiting objects in our solar system that could make for other projects. Which is fun, just like as an idea to, like, hang all these sounds on.
Yeah. It's a good concept, because I don't think anyone's ever done that before, and I don't know why, but I think about space a lot, like, with music.
Yeah,
love it.
Yeah.
And it was only, like, 2 or 3 years ago I found out that there's no sound in space.
Right.
And I was like, oh, yeah, and I was like, wait, now I'm not kind of like, you know, but I still think about it.
Yeah. I mean, it's an interesting time to focus on space as an idea, because it's not... I mean, people have done, like, space rock going back to the 60s, like, you know, Love Hawkman and all that stuff, but it's not fiction anymore. And that's what makes it interesting to me, is, like, it's inspiring to me. Like, in a way, I think the focus on space for me as a songwriting thing is my kind of, like, atheist version of getting into religious music in your middle age. Like, that's not my thing, but, like, I find space inspiring. And it's not this, like, abstract, like, thing anymore when people are, like, in our lifetimes, we're going to be, you know, sending people to Mars, like, you know, in the near future. I feel like we should maybe introduce everybody. So, like, Dan Friel, guitar vocals, Jeff Ottenbacher, drums, Todd Bailey, bass guitar, Todd Bailey is on the new record, but is tagging in to help out for Jason Finnick, who played bass since 2018 with us, but is out of commission with injury and work. Worth noting also that Todd Bailey makes engines for spacecraft.
That's how you got the job. Like,
so you're hoping to, visit each of these planets and play your record on the surface if possible if it's a rocky one.
We're trying to raise money by playing pizza by pizza.
But you're going to get that hookup where it's like, okay, now I'm going to take you to Mars and this is, you know, this is the record we wrote for you, so here we go.
It's
going
to take a while to build that tour vehicle. But
we're working on it now. I mean, Todd's working on the propulsion mechanism with that. Hey, we're running an old GMT. It's a 1976, but I think it can be retrofitted.
It's going to be hard to play a show on Mercury because I got no sound. We'll figure it out.
And then what if you get to Mars and they don't like the Mars record? Like, I made this for you.
Wait, we have a record that's not red. We have a record that's not red about Mars.
Yeah, but the crowd on Mars, rough. I mean, you really got to win.
Yo,
over
you guys.
Quick.
I love you guys.
Oh, yeah.
Right on.
Thanks,
like,
right. Have a good night.
Then you're like, ever since John Carter, man, we don't want to see John Carter.
Todd and I had a sci-fi book club going for a while. Definitely, like, started me on this path.
Because you have a song, too, about UFO books. Just to go with the whole space idea.
Not our song.
What?
It's a cover.
But you still sing it. You
that's
still
true.
Sing it on your
that's
record.
True.
So you're still singing about UFOs.
Yeah, yeah.
So, just like going with the space idea, you know. I mean, I remember during the pandemic that most people don't remember that they admitted that, like, alien life was real, and then they kind of, like, stopped talking about it for a while.
I mean, yeah. It's been a complicated thing where, like, it's interesting to see the government sort of playing along a little bit, but also they're not really offering any new information.
You're talking about like the declassified gun cameras.
Every once in a while, it's like Area 51 is real, and you know we've got the aliens and everything, and then.
Well, the better conspiracy, I mean, if you're into conspiracy theories about aliens, because the outlaw Russian like interstellar objects, give a name.
Something like
that.
Like the long sort of cylindrical thing that was definitely from outside.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, the fact is, like, you know, like, alright, so, I actually work in space, so please trust me when I say it's fact. The trajectory and velocity of that object were such that it's most likely that it came from outside of the solar system. You can try and pronounce that.
That's a Momma. That's a rare.
Yeah, right. Anyway, whatever. That object came in. There's this professor, I think it's a Harvard professor, Avi Loeb, who's got a whole book about this, but that object came in from outside of the solar system and was totally flying, like, by which I mean moving rapidly, at a high speed, even more an interstellar object. And the thing that everybody, like, tripped everybody up about it is not only was it a strange shape, it, you know, as its orbit changed as it went around the sun, it had a non-gravity-related acceleration, which sometimes is common in comets that are outgassing, but this wasn't a comet, and they were like, well, how is it changing velocity? That's typical of a spacecraft. So there's a small but significant percentage of scientists that are like, well, Occam's razor says if it accelerated, and it's not a comet. There's only a couple other things it could be.
Yep.
And so that, if it, like, as far as, like, you know, like woo-woo theories about aliens, that's my favorite one.
Yep.
It's been like Rendezvous with Rama type shit.
Well, I mean, again, like, you know that book? I mean, like, circling back to the thing I was saying before, like, the thing that's, like, fun to me is, like, it's not fiction to, like, write about, like, some of this shit at this point, because
sure.
As we learn more and more about the solar system and more about the universe, more of these things are going to come up that are like, you know, we can't yet say, like, that is alien life, but, like, we definitely cannot
that's
explain
really
any of
that.
You know, thank you.
Thank
you
very
much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Hexer 2.
Bender next?
It's no, it's just a regular old Hagstrom tube. Love a Hagstrom. You get a sponsor.
You don't love that guitar.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I mean, it's a very good looking Hagstrom too. It's very great. I have another one that is way fucked up looking, and I've never really garnered that amount of love.
No one's ever like, I like how you took the pick card off and it's tape on your shirt.
But yeah, bass is a good theme, dude, because it's just...
Infinite?
Yeah, and it's just... we know what's there, but we don't really know what's there, so it's, like, great to just kind of... You know, I mean, I think it's very naive to think, like, Earth is the only thing, which is, like, what a lot of people call for such a long time, where it's like, oh, there can't be more intelligent life out there. It's, like, there's barely intelligent life here.
I think one of the things that, like... that's so cool. People like a thing that's hopeful. Like, everyone wants something to go for that's not like a project.
That's not what? A project. They want a project. Like,
well, a project, but also like a belief that there is more. A belief that there is, like, you know, with work and purpose comes like illumination and new things. And like, I don't know, I think that's why sci-fi is big. I think that's why everyone is in the space, because it's like, no one knows. You know, I'm trying to avoid using the word, the final frontier, but like, there's like, you know, there's truth to that, right? Or at least it's the final frontier now. Like, it's going to be awesome in 2,000 years when it's not.
Yeah, when they got some new ass frontier.
Yeah. And they're not going to be like, Alaska, the final frontier. Which I believe it was. I think Alaska was the final frontier up until like 50 years ago. And then they were like, okay, now it's
like, relatively speaking, it's like, you think about the way, like, technology is now, and, like, even in, like, the 90s, if you were, like, you know, all this stuff, like, the phone, the camera, like, the internet, it's
actually,
all going
to
be...
with respect to space technology, bullshit. Space technology is actually not advanced all that much, which is a real bummer. A lot of the, like, turning inward types of technologies, like the fucking internet and phone and, like, media, have advanced a ton, but, like, we have to go to a rocket engine. Hasn't changed. We're going to run around with a great rocket, and, like, not a lot of them are that much better now. And that, to me, is, like, this is, like, also, like, channeling Crusty and Shirley as Buzz Aldrin. But, like, you know, I don't know. Like, it's the hard problems that are, like, the ones that are stagnating also right now.
You know, it should be easier for us to go into space now than it was, like, you know, before the 21st century.
I think it's less of a priority.
Well, once global warming kicks in, we'll be bought out of here, and then they'll be like, throw all that money in space.
No, I don't know if those two timelines quite line up.
There has to be a fascinating class struggle there, at least.
Yeah,
I know. It's gonna be I watched the Simpsons Treehouse of Horror where they put everyone in the rocket to go off into space and everyone else into the sun. Like all the losers go into the sun, and it's just like, you get a rocket too. You get to get off the planet.
Yeah.
And that's gonna happen one day, because mainly because Tom Arnold's still alive. So it's gotta happen.
Wait. Who?
Tom Arnold.
Oh, I think it's Tom Morello. And I was like, wait, he's a space guy?
What?
My favorite genre is people who didn't know that Rage Against the Machine was Raging Against the Machine. Like, all the people who were, like, hardcore Republicans that were like, never listening to this music again. I didn't know this one was.
I am shocked. They're raging against me.
Like, I'm the machine. I'm the problem.
Yeah, where do you draw the batting box on this one?
Yeah, wasn't there a thing where, like, the Winklevoss twins were doing, like, live covers of Rage Against the Machine songs? Did you see those videos?
Yep.
We should probably wrap this so we can figure out where
we're going. There's somebody there that wants to buy a CD, and I didn't know where they were.
Oh, shit.
You're like, what's a CD?
They're still in there? They're still in there. Okay.
Okay.
Are we good?
This is good, yeah.
Okay.